Da 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 da. Penguin Random House Audio presents Wildflower. This is the author, Drew Barrymore. To my friend family, my flower family, my Copelman family, and my daughters, thank you. You taught me everything I know. Preface. I wrote this book without assuming anyone would ever read it. And yet, I wrote it for you, the person listening to this right now. If it feels personal for you, then I am so happy because it was personal for me. I didn't write it in any particular format. This is not a sweeping life story, but an elaboration on times in my life as I remembered them. I asked myself from time to time over the course of exactly 1 year, what should I revisit? Or what story should I tell? Because to me, these are stories. My publisher wanted to call this a memoir at first, but that didn't sound right. Memoir seemed heavy to me, and I wanted this to be light. This is a book you can dip into or listen to whenever you want. A book you can read when you want. A book you can listen to when you want. But I can only hope that every once in a while it catches you inconveniently feeling something. It was inconvenient writing it with two young daughters. They are my universe, and I felt terrible pulling myself away from them to write. Ever. But every mother knows how this feels. However, I discovered that over this year, that being a mother is at times hardest in the transitions. Pulling yourself away, you feel like the devil. But once you do, you can be more present. And the gift is that once you pull yourself away from your responsibilities, you can fully be a parent. It's being present that matters most. And when I was writing, I shut my door. I would let the inspiration flow. For some reason, I had to write this book. I have become more private every year, and yet these stories were beating at the door of my heart, screaming, "Let me out!" Maybe it was that I have always dreamed of being a writer. Those people who do the typing and the transporting are my heroes. I have never been able to do that. I have never been brave enough, smart enough, had enough to say. I had not exercised those abilities in my life. And now I have, alone in a room. And yet, as I say in the book, you do nothing in this life alone. And most of all, you do not live alone. And therefore, we all have stories to tell. These are mine. Wildflower, a poem. Out there in the world of chaos, all the concrete and fumes, people with determination behind the wheel, the soles of their feet wiser, some faces with souls of routine, others with high hope of their destination, among all the human and industrial invention, my eyes find a tiny wildflower. With pretty yellow petals and a brown button nose, reminding me that there is beauty everywhere. A compass of nature, a second of stillness in my mind, as my heart races to the rhythms of its swaying in the wind. You are that flower, reminding me of what is real. Birds of Paradise. In 1975, the neighborhood I grew up in, West Hollywood, was a colorful place. It had an aesthetic of old cars, the way one idealizes Havana, and the wildly different styles of architecture from one house or apartment building to another. Santa Monica Boulevard with its pimps and old movie theaters, and the drag queens. That was just a fact. that the kids from our hood grew up with. Mom, is it a man or a woman? And then the parents could probably individually decide how to answer. But having this colorful world all around is what made this area so interesting. My mother, then named Ildiko Jade, raised me as a single mother there. She was an aspiring actress who did bit parts here and there and worked two jobs at the infamous Comedy Store and also at the notorious music venue, the Troubadour. She was living a life around many wild artists, and the whole scene of that era was very hedonistic. She was also friends with many gay men, so that just became a part of life too. Their style and their wit were comforting. We lived on Poinsettia Place in a tiny duplex that had a giant wall of bougainvillea up the front, about 25 feet high, which to a little kid seemed like a skyscraper. And it made our place stand out on the street. This dramatic, hardy flower with its deep maroon made me so happy. I was so in love with its color, and it taught me that beauty could live in any seedy area. Not only live, but be strong. We lived on one side of the duplex, and our neighbor on the other side was Joni Goodfellow. Her son was Daniel Faircloth, and it was only after years later that it struck me how distinct their names were. At the time, she was just another single mom, much like mine, whose man had taken off, leaving just her and the kid. I still can't remember the name of the father, but I remember he was from somewhere like Delaware or Denver, neither place I knew or geography in general, but every time she talked about him, I would picture him in a Western shirt or cowboy boots. Don't ask me why. Men left and moms worked were the messages I was receiving from our lives in this duplex. I still have no clue what Joni did. Joni was eccentric. She had electric blue hair or neon green and would slink around the apartment like an exhibitionist with very little clothing, often having two cockatoos perched one on each shoulder. At first, I was wide-eyed about it, but eventually I would have been more shocked to find it any different. Strange what we get used to. Her son Daniel became my best friend, even though I didn't even know what that was at the time. But we would sell apples up and down the street and beat the shit out of each other. A typical West Hollywood friendship, I think. When it was time for him to go to bed, every night was the same routine. Joni would say, "Okay, time for bed." And he would immediately start climbing the curtains in their living room. It was as if he was in a gym making his way up the rope. He would scream, "I don't wanna go to bed!" When he had almost reached the top, Joni would just pluck him off and throw him in the bedroom down the hall. Our duplexes each had two bedrooms. It seemed spacious to me. I was actually proud that these single moms could provide a two-bedroom situation for us kids. To have all our own rooms was nothing to scoff at. There was also a teeny tiny backyard with a cheap swing set and an avocado tree. To say that I ate 10 avocados a day off that tree was no exaggeration. I loved that tree. It nourished me, and other than the cascading bougainvillea out front, it was my only source of nature. Just like me, the tree and the flower bush didn't mind that they were existing amongst crime and X-rated movie theaters. We were all just really happy in our fantasy land. In fact, the significance of the avocado tree is still as strong as can be for me. I even have it in my will that I want to be buried under one, or have some of my ashes put there. Some avocado tree, preferably on a hill that is nowhere near anything this time. Just up a hill on a rolling mountain, preferably with an ocean view. I can dream. For now, my nature consisted of the things living and growing at Poinsettia Place. And most jarring to me was the strange-looking plant on the side of the house. There was a narrow, long driveway that led from front to back, all concrete. It was where my mom would park her beat-up, discolored, temperamental old Volkswagen Karmann Ghia. But alongside the driveway, lining the house, were plants called birds of paradise. They have a long, pale green stalk with bright orange pointy petals and some blue accents. Picture the colors that the gas stove burner emits. Blues and oranges. They are spiky and they look like they belong in Palm Springs or the Galapagos.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.